Once you find the sign for 40-acre rock on Highway 601, you'll realize you really are on the right road. Follow the map available from the D.N.R. around to the parking lot at the end of Conservancy Road and lace up your boots. A short walk down the dirt trail leads you to the edge of this huge expanse of granite. Welcome to the top of 40-acre rock. Although it's really only 14 acres across, there's still plenty of surface to explore. From where you just stepped out, walk to your left down the edge of the rock and we'll do a quick loop on the trail. You'll find the trailhead about halfway down the edge of the rock face, just beneath a chestnut oak tree. Now, there's no guarantee he'll still be there, but this eastern fence lizard was sunning himself on a nearby rock when we visited. We just weren't sure if he was the greeter or the guard. You'll notice immediately that the trail begins dropping quickly, so you know you have a climb ahead of you to get back out. The trail is well marked with these signs, and there are blazes on the trees as well to help you stay on course. You'll notice rocks, large and small, all along the trail, and you can only imagine how much granite there must be just below the surface. Just as prevalent as the many boulders are these acorns in the autumn months from the chestnut oak trees. You'll need to be careful of these. All of us did some unplanned dance moves when the acorns and the steep slope combined to cause some fancy balance work. It's all worth it when you reach this waterfall. This would be the perfect spot for a sit-down and a candy bar. But be sure any snack wrappers leave when you do. As you walk past the small stream below the waterfall that eventually flows into Flat Creek, you will come to the first of several footbridges. This first one had a dainty little lady's trusses beside it, so named for its spiraling stalk that resembles ringlets of hair. It's an easy walk for a while now, along the creek in the narrow floodplain. To your left, you'll see the base of another large rock formation. I bet you'll see that again in a few minutes. Pay close attention to the creek. You're likely to see lots of life, like these minnows darting among the shadows of fallen leaves. Or you might be lucky enough to see the deer that left these tracks in the sand. The trail continues to wind along the creek, past these ink-capped mushrooms bursting upward through the leafy mat of the forest floor. And in a true chicken-or-the-egg conundrum, you have to wonder if this mushroom-shaped rock by the creek was the copycat or the model for all these little guys that grow around it. Now the floodplain narrows until the creek is pushed up against this moss and lichen-covered rock face. Juniper moss maintains a fragile toehold above the small pools filled with even more chestnut oak acorns. And it all dribbles ever downward, past the autumn bell, and across the broad flat slide to where the plain broadens again near the last footbridge. This would be a good time to mention that this trail does have a few obstacles, like this tree that you'll need to climb over. Some of the trails can be a bit steep and rocky too, so make sure you can navigate all these woodland speed bumps before venturing in this far. And now, it's payback time. Just beyond the fifth footbridge, the trail splits. Take a deep breath and start that haul up the hill to your right. Again, this is a short but steep climb, so pace yourself. When you emerge at this point of the trail, you're just a short walk from the top of 40-acre rock, where you came in. This would be a perfect time to stroll around the shallow pools that make this heritage preserve so important. Depending on the water depth and the soil buildup, you might find pigeon moss, ragworts, quillwort, or maybe a few stunted red cedars. It's all a matter of primary succession.
And as other plants from their propagules, their seeds and rhizomes, come in, they'll start filling in the pool, and succession will take place. That is, one group of plants will overtake another group of plants, such that the whole vegetation structure changes. As you can see, this plant succession is quite well on its way with all these sedges, mosses, flowering plants, and even a loblolly to the detriment and demise of the quill work.
As a result of this shallow soil, you'll also find a number of uprooted trees whose mass has outgrown what the roots can support. It's also a dry environment, but many plants have adapted.
From the point of view of all the plants out here, it's really quite dry. It's almost desert-like, you could say. And that's because of the shallowness of the soil. When it rains, there just isn't enough soil to hold it, at least hold it for very long. So within a couple of days after that rain, it's awfully dry out here as far as these plants are concerned. So plants have evolved different strategies for coping with that dryness. One that we're all familiar with is the cactus. What the cactus does, of course, it just stores a lot of water in the thick succulent tissue, and it defends it with thorns, as we all know. Another strategy is the resurrection fern here. It looks almost dead, although when you look close, you can see it's still green. And if we had a good all-day soaking rain, this dead-looking fern would, as its name suggests, resurrect quite nicely. So its strategy, you might say, is to become dormant during a dry spell.
And now, before you head back to your car, look straight out across at that large rock on the other side and say, "Hey, that's the top of the rock I walked past down by the creek." Sure enough. And like the stone beneath you, we'll just take it for granted that you had a rock-solid good time at 40-acre Rock Heritage Preserve.